Thank you. It's nice there. It's very nice to be here. It's a pleasure. Everyone's so talented. I feel very humbled and very honored to be here. I think I'm supposed to press something here. I'm very fascinated by this theme of things being out of control, partly because I always feel like that in my life, professional life and personal life. And because I'm fascinated by, I'm kind of a designer because it's a bit of a mixture of disciplines and film and graphic design and things, branding. And I'm fascinated by how designers try to control things around them, try to control the world with grids and kerning and leading and spacing and try to make everything really beautiful. Meanwhile, everything is so out of control around us. And like you said, I've been now for 2 years a partner at Pentagram, which is quite a classic grassroots, I'd describe, design practice. Quite a proper, until I arrived probably, quite a proper practice. I am there in the middle. Every 6 months we meet, and all the partners around the world, we are 18 of us, and we discuss, we look at all the work we're doing and so on. And you're thinking, probably give a shit. Why is she talking about this proper stuff? But the reason is that I always get asked why and how do you cope with being the first female partner, as if this is a real big deal. It is a bit odd that we haven't had in London a female partner before. But for me, back to the out of control thing, I have to confess that it is complicated life and work, and very full-on work, and I'm sure all of you who work a lot agree, and all of you who are mums of young children and female or not female, I think all of that comes to life. So the truth is, behind this proper and very kind of polite and middle-class appearance that I think Pentagram in a way gives to the world, which is very elegant and nice, I feel a bit like when I look at myself, I have young twins and there's a lot of out of control life and a lot of chaos, and the work looks like it's going really well, but then I'm seeing myself completely, oh my God, and I'm hoovering and I forgot to turn the hoover on, and I go to the petrol station and I put petrol on a diesel car, and I'm driving, and I have the bag on top of the car, and I go by tube home, and I drove to work, and the car is there, and I managed to lose a pram that is like a double pram, 1 meter square, red, I forgot it in the middle of the road, and I'm trying to open the door to the house with my Oyster card. I'm sure a lot of people do that. And I find a banana that's been there for a month in my bag. My team is here and they know it's daily. It's not like weekly even. They know it's true. And that's how we function. And it's all the time. And that out of control, but then the appearance of being in control and doing beautiful design contrast is there all the time. And that's how I think a lot of us who have family and I think women tend to take this double life a lot more in a strange way, and it makes it harder. But the formula and the secret is I've gotten the most amazing team, which is there. We at Pentagram are like a bunch of startups, really. It's a lovely way of working. I feel very liberated. Since I joined there, because no one tells you what to do. You're your own boss, and I have this amazing team that's very international. There's one amazing person missing there because he wasn't there on the day we took the picture, who is a Chinese man called Hamlet. It's a very odd decision, but he named himself when he moved. and he is amazing, like everyone who's there is amazing, and they're all really talented and lovely. I think to me it's really important that I find that we can only work well with people you adore almost, you feel good to be with, you feel that they are truly on your side and you have to collaborate and not compete with, otherwise the work suffers. I think some people feel that you have to be stressed and shouting at each other, and I don't feel that that is a way to... I think we have to own the work together and not feel like this is my route and that's your route. And we, like, all the work we do is really, like, could not have been done without each other, and we kind of... it's really collective. So it feels like we're a bunch of startups, and each partner really has their own team, and they work, you know, we all work in quite a different way, multidisciplinary. So some of us are more branding, others are architects, others are the industrial designers, and so on. So, but this out of control thing is a theme I'm really interested in, and a lot of it I get in just watching my children, who now actually are not pram age anymore, but they're six, the twins, and just watching how they wake up in the morning with their hair, and I've been taking just pictures of that, and I think it's so lovely how every day is different, but you can tell how busy the night was, and I just love it. It's truly, I mean, this was last week. You just took him out of the house, and because you just think, my God, what kind of dreams did you have? And this is... one of them. The other one is, and the hair is straight, it's not at all, and the other one is always normal, but Alfie always has it like that, so it just does funny things, and I love that, the fact that there must be some real kind of funny dream action going on. Anyway, but out of control comes also from my background. I was born in Brazil, which is a country where I don't need to explain, you're watching what's going on. And I find it so funny that anyone is surprised that nothing is finished for the World Cup and half of the stadium. I mean, none of the stadiums is done. And someone was testing the waters for the Olympics for sailing, I think, the other day. They sent a specialist, and the specialist was sailing and bumped into a sofa. And I thought, well, I was so not surprised. I thought, I mean, it's real, and I was just like, that's the kind of thing. It's sad, but it's so Brazil. It's so like that. And but I, in that comedy, tragedy thing, I find a lot of inspiration, and I find it amazing that, you know, this out of control thing, that people find so many ways around things, and they always... there's so much ingenuity in that. And I once did a talk for Typographic Circle, and they asked me to choose a word, and I chose the word saudade because it has, it's a word that only exists in Portuguese, it's a very Brazilian word, which means nostalgia, but it's kind of nostalgia. And this typeface was designed by a designer who was working with us at the time, who is Indian, and is a very ornamental typeface. And I like the fact that it's very lazy ornamental. It's not about being functional. It's not about getting there, but it's about celebrating every step of the journey almost. And another talk was for long lunch. And this word, ginga, is also a Brazilian word, which is from capoeira. And it's a movement that you kind of, from capoeira, that you, when you try and get out of, in the, you know, in the from the, let's say, fight, it's not exactly a fight, but it's also how women and people move their bodies when they walk. So it's, again, not functional, but very specific of the body movement and the kind of laziness, and it's very Brazilian. So lots of things, I won't talk too much about Brazil, but just the beginning here, which are about this out of control and inventiveness. And got back to a couple of pictures that refer back to this thing about improvisation, not bothering with safety, which is Brazil. The way that we negotiate things in Brazil, this is, I'm sure, going on there every minute at the moment. This is how we kind of find our way. And this is, again, how we deal with safety. So I won't go on because I can go on for hours on this subject, but I find that I mean, it makes me smile. It's something that I, you know, meanwhile, when I see design trying to control everything, I grew up watching this, so I can't be that designer that I love craft and I totally admire, and that's so much why I joined Pentagram, and what I see around me, I find lovely, and that's why I've got a team that I think does things in a very useful way, and I really admire that. But at the same time, I get inspired by this craziness and the way that people do things, and I think we have to both learn from life and see this, and also be able to craft and shape things to build beautiful things. But I grew up in a world of color. Then I came to England to study at Royal College of Art, which was a place that really changed me a lot, or helped me kind of find my own path, because it's a place that is very much about celebrating individual talent. There's no formula, it's a platform, you grow, find your own way, it's amazing. And I met lots of friends, and I met amazing tutors, and it was really, really amazing. And from that amazing world of color, I then one day met a man from Bolton, and that was the other side of life, and I got to learn the other side of life and try to understand a different side of beauty. And I also started to look and understand also another side of culture and beauty, which is this, this is England's side of beauty, which I find very fascinating.
Oh. Are you smoking?
No.
I just saw you smoking a cigarette, and you know you're not allowed to smoke cigarettes here.
No, but, yeah, but, no, but, yeah, but, no, but, yeah, but, oh my God, that is so unfair. Everybody knows I gave up smoking when I was, like, 9.
So, some things took me a while to get my head around. And other things as well, I have to confess. And other things even more. But I think that London is the most stunning city to live and to find your identity and to celebrate the person you want to be and yourself and find other, you know, cultures and all of that. And I think that that's been a great place to be and to you know, become a designer and all of those things. So it has been amazing. It is, I think, the best place for me to be a designer, I absolutely love. And, you know, there's so many pictures of these different identities, and it is the whole world in one city, really, as we all know. And all of this is great in terms of identity and finding our own identities and celebrating, and it's such an open stage. So that for me has been great in terms of creating work, and I very much believe in design, not as in a design that has any rules before the ideas. I think the ideas shape the rules, and the rules will be really important once you've got the ideas and they kind of define how things should look as they go along. But back to the children, I think, and Marion this morning said, and Marion is someone I very much relate to, and we know each other for a while, and I love her work. And, you know, she talked about children, and we often do workshops for children in schools in need, or whichever way you describe that. And it's so sad how you see how children lose creativity as they grow up. And there is this TED Talk that you probably have seen of Ken Robinson, where he talks about this little boy drawing in a school, when he asked, "What are you drawing?" And he says, "God." And then he says, "But no one knows what God looks like." And then the boy says, "They will in a minute." And it is so amazing. And then we grow up and we get full of... And it's such a shame. So to me, this is obvious, and I'll pass quickly, but I just keep looking at my children, and I know it's not my children, it's any children, and just learning from them constantly, and these crazy things they say all the time. So just very quickly, their glossary: strangled eggs, ghost cheese, gorilla ice cream, which is vanilla ice cream, soil milk, screwdriver, which is the screwdriver, tusky, Wallace and pomegranate, paintyful, air conditioning, and then some, just a few fundamental questions. What happens if you don't have a skeleton? And then they followed saying, is it like a tent that won't, no, is it like a blanket that wants to be a tent but doesn't have the legs? Or do spiders have armpits? Do bacteria have legs? Is it dark inside me? It gets a bit more. Is love magic? How do I know when I'm awake and when I'm dreaming? I mean, it's existentialist. What's inside a mosquito? Why did you didn't? And because why? And then this is, I know designers do this and it's boring. Okay, everyone takes pictures of signs, but these pictures were taken by that wonderful team, my team, that you saw the picture. And we love the words here because they're so funny and poetic. To Kill a Mockingbird, Peter Pan, Titanic, I mean. And then we designers come with our phenomenal fees and we charge all this money to do naming and to do these things, and then we kill all of that. And then sometimes you think, I'm not sure if we, you know what I mean? It's so lovely. So far, so good. Walk this way. Indian. Frying in. Abracadabra. And then this is such a happy accident. Cross-eyed clinics. Cash 22. And Google cars. And then finally, this is near our house, actually. Oh, no, sorry, it's the next one. There's Bits and Pieces, and there's two more, actually. Jack the Stripper, the floors, tiny up. Doremi, the Codfather, this is in Ireland. That's in. That's in Stoke Newington. If you want to pay a visit, Stoke Newington. So, I mean, all copywriting, isn't it? It's so lovely. Anyway, and then meanwhile, we're trying to control. Align the sun with Jupiter and do those guidelines that say, don't do this, don't do that. This is, we chose one that we did, actually, just to not be rude to anyone else, you know, and do nots. And so it's just good to look around sometimes at, you know, what we do versus the world outside and think about it. And then sometimes when designers get involved, this is a real sex shop sign. And then we think about what would happen to it had a fancy company been hired. And we did a couple more, actually. So this one is Brazilian. It says, snacks, hamburger, pizza, and God save you. And then we thought, this is what... And then we picked some of our work that we did when at Wolf Orleans. I was part of this job that we created this brand for Macmillan. And a great part of it is that we created a bespoke font, and the whole point of it is that it's a voice, it's a brand that is owned and you recognize because you recognize the typeface. So there's some people that, I just thought, how can you do all of this in Helvetica? It would be a bit odd, wouldn't it? So, and then, you know, some of other brands that we will. Anyway, I won't keep banging. This is a Tate. This has been removed now, but we did a timeline with lovely Sarah Fanelli, who's a very close friend of mine. and we did it all in handwritten, because it's all about how things are not precise when you do a timeline, and how, you know, it's quite dreamy and the connections are very loose. And then we thought, maybe that's what would happen. Anyway, enough of that introduction, which is bigger than the talk. Don't worry, this is most of it. I just thought now I'll show a little bit of work, so you can fall asleep now. I do a bit of film and a bit of design branding kind of thing. So I'll show a few things which are very old and a few things which are very recent. So first, a couple of films, if I don't.
Hey, come down. Bound, 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 hey, hey.
Side for sore eyes, it's a long time no see.
This is very old, when I finished college, and I think the point of showing this is it's one of these things that's totally out of control. You cannot direct the bags. They fly as they want. And we did it in 96, so much before American Beauty, if anyone's thinking. We even tried to sue them because it was done for MTV. And anyway, and that generated a series. So I'm just going to show one more, very little of that. And again, all sort of out of control. You can see my age from the appliances. I was about 5 years old when I did those. And then I won't talk about the rest. I'll just kind of click through. They're all identities that are quite open, based on the same idea of not trying to control. With Tate, it was very much about always changing, but always being Tate, an identity that was very flexible. We did this about... It's almost 15 years ago, and then we made it, we refreshed it about 3-4 years ago. So this was at Wolf Orleans. I was creative director, first designer, then creative director at Wolf Orleans. And then we did South Bank, which was about creating something that was very much about new chemistry and like almost like an open weave. That, you know, about different disciplines coming together, audiences and so on. Macmillan, very much a voice, you know, for all people, because we're all going to be affected by cancer somehow, friends, us. So a voice that represented that force, really, to fight cancer. Amnesty, very much a singular-minded thing that reversed, in a way, intervened against something very strong that united all these different points of view about not just prisoners, but so many issues around human rights. And then Oxfam, a bit more recently, was the last job I worked on at Wolf Orleans. We made it much more practical, but much more of a visionary as well, not so academic and Oxford-like, but from everywhere in the world. Designed a typeface. The team that worked with me on this, they are here actually on these jobs. Both Ian and Hiromi, they are working with me now, and they are wonderful. We designed the typeface, we refreshed the logo, and they also worked on South Bank. And then these are more recent, we did the Serpentine Identity, which is also an open, elastic identity because it's in the park, it's open, it's about an identity that allows for change and allows, you know, it's also in an open landscape and allows for different points of view. And I know we have to finish. We did also the restaurant is a kind of an identity within. This is a pitch that we won, but then they didn't give us the job for the foundation of Louis Vuitton in Paris. It's inspired by their building, but it's about, you know, travel, which is what they're about. I'm going quite quick now, but all of these are identities which are open. So not try not to control too much. That was the other route that we created. Also about travel, inspired by the boats and the building and the spirit of discovery. This is the second route that we did. So just showing also things that sometimes don't come to life because life is complicated. And I thought, just to finish, I thought I'd show something that is quite controlled, which is a film for Richard Rodgers.
If there's a word which I suppose would dominate my thinking, it is humanism. And there's a link to Italy, of course, the whole humanistic philosophy and the Renaissance. I was born in Florence. As it happens, I was born more or less overlooking Brunelleschi's wonderful dome. I was strongly influenced by my mother, who was a potter. Coming from Italy, with very modern views, she sheltered me from fear of the new, the shock of the new. I was greatly influenced by her view, and my father's too, of art as being part of life. Of all the greatest things that I enjoy, it's culture, and aesthetic is a primary part of culture. Humanizing is a critical element about planning and architecture and creating buildings that encourage and spaces that encourage that humanism. I believe strongly in ethics, fairness, ethos. Public space is the physical manifestation of human values. Individuals have rights to public space. There should be a law that everybody can see at least a tree from their window. I was very much involved in my teens in political and social environment, and of course, campaigning is a critical part of this. I've always been more interested in periods of change, therefore I prefer early Renaissance, early Gothic, and early modern in a way, to overrich architecture of the later periods. I'm searching for an aesthetic which allows for change, the ability of buildings to respond. Like a sunflower opening to the sun, buildings have to open and absorb the sun, or buildings have to adapt. I have a very beautiful watch from my mother. It's very much inside out because it wears its machine on the outside. It's a very beautiful watch in terms it's all colors, and I love color. You see the workings of it. So in a way, it encapsulates what I do. We as architects are both scientists and artists. You express the process of construction, so the way you put a building together. Materials are a very key part of the aesthetic of a building. It's the humanization of the parts so that they are legible, just like my watch. All those little bits in the watch give scale. Scale is key to architecture. It's your hand, and your hand is really the imprint that you put on everything. Things out of scale means that there is no relationship to the human body, to your hand, and then you feel frightened. And in fact, that's exactly what fascist architecture is. As no man is an island, nor is any building or any space, everything flows from one to the other. The beginning of a city is the room. And then you put a lot of rooms and you make a house, and then you make lots of houses and you make a city. So there isn't very clear definition between inside, outside, or small and large. It's how you give order to those pieces. I see the earth which we inhabit. When you fly over at nighttime, you see all the lights on, you don't see borders. That's how it should be. But the idea that the globe is made out of many races, many cultures, and that you work with these and they enrich you, It's not about terrible division which we're faced with, poor countries, rich countries. It's about the intermingling of people within a state which is fair.